Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us for this Big Data at Heart webinar. Today, we hope to answer the question, did generics for cardiovascular disease kill research and development? Novel druggable targets using proteomics and genomics. My name is Duane Schultes. I'm the Managing Director of Vital Transformation. Thank you very much for joining us today. So the treatment of cardiovascular disease in many ways can be seen as a success story. With lipid-lowering statins now widely available, the treatment of high blood pressure, high cholesterol, and many other common heart conditions that used to kill many people is now both cheap and effective. However, this process poses a challenge. How do you develop new therapies harnessing genomics and proteomics when effective lipid-lowering drugs are now almost free? As we've seen in several recent cases, monoclonal antibodies that are significantly more effective than available generics in treating high cholesterol have been marketing failures. The IMI Project Big Data at Heart is attempting to address this problem by harnessing large data sets to identify druggable targets that have both efficacy and marketing potential. And I'm extremely pleased to be joined by three excellent speakers from the project who will give their opinions and presentations today. Firstly, I'd like to introduce you to Jessica Van Setten from UMC Utrecht. Jessica, thank you for joining us today. It's a pleasure.
Thank you, Jay.
And we're also joined today by Florian Schmidt from University College London. Hello, Florian. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
The subtle laid-back approach, Florian. Thank you very much. Always appreciate it. And also Adam Butterworth from University of Cambridge. Hello, Adam. How are you?
Hi, Duane. Great. Thanks. Pleased to join you today.
Thank you. We look forward to having your inputs, folks. So firstly, we'd like to give Jessica the floor. She's going to give us a presentation of some of her research work. And Jessica, the floor is yours. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your very kind introduction. So I want to start off today with giving you a little bit of background of what what I've been doing over the past couple of years and focusing on two different projects, one on the common genetic variants and one on specifically loss of function variants. Just to make sure, because I think we have a pretty broad audience, that we're all on the same page before I start. So our genome contains of 3 billion base pairs, or different letters as we used to call them. And if you have these chromosomes and you unwind these, you can actually sort of see those base pairs. And the letters that we use are A, T, G, and C. And the order of the letters actually sort of makes us into who we are. Together, they encode about 20,000 genes, and we know that about 99.9%, actually there needs to be another 0.9% behind this, of our DNA is identical between two individuals, which means that about 1 in 1,000 bases is actually different between those people. And in my research, I am interested in that 0.1% of our DNA that is different between individuals. And we study those doing so-called genome-wide association studies, or GWAS. And this is just a little bit of a toy example to show how this works.
Okay, so this example you see here, let's assume we have a cohort with 2,000 samples. So we have 1,000 cases with cardiac disease, and we have 1,000 controls without any heart disease. And what we then can do is, for each and every single genetic variant that we tested in these people, we can determine what percentage of people in each group have the one allele of that variant and the one letter and or the other letter. So in this case, you would have the C allele and the T allele, and the C allele would be much more common in the cases, and in controls it would be sort of a similar number. And now you can do a statistical test to determine if it's significantly different between the two groups. So we can do this for all variants that we want to test. And currently we're usually testing anywhere between, let's say, 20 and 100 million variants. So in this graph, you actually see the results of the study I want to highlight today. So this was within the CHARGE EKG working group published a couple of years ago, where we did a large GWAS of PR interval. So the PR interval on the electrocardiogram is actually shows the conduction of the atrium, and it's actually pretty strongly associated with atrial fibrillation. So that's why we were very interested to study this. And what you see here is a so-called Manhattan plot, and it shows the results of association study of, I think it was about 2.8 million variants. On the x-axis, you see the chromosome position of each of the variants, on the y-axis, minus log 10 of the p-value. So if you go up on the y-axis here, it actually becomes more significant. And every single dot here that you see is one genetic variant that we tested for PR association with PR interval. And everything here above this dashed line that you see is actually genome-wide significant, which we call it if it's actually significantly associated with PR interval. And this is, of course, you know, there's thousands or tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of these types of studies done all over the world for all different traits. And I think it's really amazing because there's so much new biology that you can learn from this. So at the point when we started this, we knew maybe about 10 genes associated with PR interval. And now at this point, we knew 50. And I think there's now an even larger study with over 100 different regions in the genome associated with PR interval. However, the difficult part is that you, of course, want to know which exact genes are involved and why specific variants in the genome are associated. And that's actually much more difficult. And that's what this graph shows maybe a little bit. So this is actually a zoom in on one of the peaks that you just saw on the previous slide. And what you see here is again, you know, the more up, more significant. And now it's all these little diamonds. But if you look at the dashed line again, you see that actually from here all the way to the left to almost all the way to the right, you see significant variance. And this does not only span one or two genes, but actually maybe five or sometimes 10 genes or even more. And it's, of course, very difficult to figure out which of those genes are actually involved in a disease or in a trait. And to do some more follow-up work on that. And to make it even more difficult is that sometimes it's regulatory variants that actually regulate genes that are, you know, even on different chromosomes. So this is for the genome-wide association studies, which have been very successful, I think. There are a few drugs now out there, but I really hope that there will be many more, and I really believe there's much more possible, but we need to do, and many people are now working on proper follow-up work. The second project I briefly want to discuss today is our project on loss of function. And loss of function mutations are actually mutations in the genome that cause a gene to be effectively knocked out or actually inactive for that gene copy where the loss of function occurs. And your typical genome, so the average genome contains about 100 loss of function mutations. And these 100 together cause about 20 completely inactivated genes, which basically means that we are on average sort of a human knockout for 20 different genes and then 20 different proteins. And the reason why we originally were interested in this because we were looking into donor recipients pairs of heart transplantation and also other solid organ transplantations. And there you can imagine that even if, you know, you are completely happy and healthy with your 20 completely inactivated genes, if you receive a heart or another organ from someone that actually expresses one of those proteins, then actually this may trigger your immune system and therefore lead to a higher rate of rejection. And actually, it turns out, you know, while we were working on this, which actually started in 2015, that there were many other reasons to be interested in loss of function mutations. And one of the reasons is that they actually are also pretty good as potential therapeutic targets, or actually to predict those. And this is just three examples, which I won't go into deeply because I think Florian will focus a little bit more on this. But there are quite a few genes that are shown to be have a high percent of human knockout and therefore and actually also show in those people very interesting phenotypes. And for this and many other reasons, we decided to focus more on loss of function, and therefore we developed a pipeline called LOFDK, which we use to identify genetic variants and also knockout genes in large genetic data sets. And with large, I actually mean really large. For instance, we're using UK Biobank data for this. So that's 500,000 people. And I think now over 100 million genetic variants that we can use to determine who actually is a sort of human knockout for which genes. Which we can use for all sorts of different interesting traits and diseases. And we aim to publish this very soon, and also hope that that actually will be used by many other people to be using for their specific traits of interest. So I think with that, I will finish my short introduction. Of course, there's many people to acknowledge, specifically for what I presented now, the Charged EKJ Working Group. iGene2 consortium for the heart transplantation, and of course the IMI working group 5 and K35, and the LOFTK development team for the loss of function pipeline.
That's great. Thank you very much, Jessica. Just a quick question. You mentioned that you're working with the UK Biobank data and roughly 500 million targets. What is the current prevalence of the loss of function mutation in the standard database that you're working with? And how is big data at heart having, ideally, what sort of database exposure would you prefer to have in order to get a better research footprint? I mean, how many numbers would you like to have ideally?
Well, for loss of function, it's, of course, it's a more the merrier, right? Though there's actually quite a few genes that are highly tolerate loss of function. So this, for instance, olfactory receptor genes, and there's quite a few more that that seems to be not so necessary to a cell to survive, where people can basically survive up to adulthood with these complete being complete knockouts. However, there's also quite a few that actually give some more sort of worse outcomes, and therefore you see them much less in the population. You need much larger sample size.
Sure.
So ideally, what you would want is to have a very large population, indeed, you know, a sample size of UK Biobank. So the 500,000 people, or, you know, ideally even more, even into the millions, but also deep phenotypes, because you need to really have this very precise information. But if you have, you know, people who are misclassified, and you only have, you know, a handful of people with a specific phenotype, and one of them is misclassified, then with these numbers, you're not going to make it.
Yeah. Well, that's great, Jessica. Thank you very much. Florian, also now, I'd like to follow up with you.
Yep.
Obviously, you're going to get into some of the specific markers that are being developed, and we look forward to your presentation, sir. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot, Dwayne, for the introduction. Let me share my screen. So first, I'd like to acknowledge, of course, my funders, NIH, UCLBRC, and the BHF, for supporting me in this work. I'll talk about Mendelian randomization for drug target validation, and as an illustration, look at CTP. So I think Jessica already talked about loss of function. And again, here's the, I think, very famous PCSK9 example now in coronary heart disease. The general caveat of loss of function design as a genetic experiment for informing drug target validation or drug development is not necessarily anything to do with the design itself. It's merely that, as Jessica alluded to before, that there aren't that many loss of function out there. And as Minical et al. Showed here as well, that the availability of a loss of function mutation is independent of the validity of your drug target. For example, PCSK9 is highly enriched for loss of function mutations or predicted loss of function mutations. Of course, that's correct because we know and have identified loss of function mutation. But arguably, the more successful statin and its drug target HMG-SIR are hardly enriched for any loss of function at all. Yet, of course, this still does not invalidate the drug target itself. So what we try to do with Mendelian randomization or drug target Mendelian randomization is to essentially increase coverage of the number of drug targets that one can consider. And we do this by leveraging aggregated data on common genetic variants to leverage this to determine an effect profile of what you would expect a drug compound that targets the same target to have on in human subjects. In design, it's very similar to the loss function analysis, focusing again on cis-acting variants from in and around the genome to encode a druggable protein or gene product, such as mRNA. We can even consider increasing coverage further by changing the exposure type that we're interested in. Most often, I think currently at least, we are interested in looking at protein drug targets, and the most logical step would there be to actually use the genetic association with protein concentration. However, as I'll show in my talk as well, we can also consider looking to use genetic association with a downstream biomarker as a proxy for protein concentration and activity. And in doing so, we can even consider using non-causal biomarkers that do not necessarily affect the outcome of interest, but by being affected by the drug target and the drug target sidestepping the biomarker, and so acting on disease through a different pathway, we can still leverage these genetic associations and thereby further increase coverage of the number of drug targets we can consider using human genetics. So I'll start with an example now discussing CETP. I think most of us will know that CETP, of course, has a very difficult history as a drug target. It once was a very, very promising, of course, for cardiovascular disease, but currently, after many failures, there's still, I think, one or maybe two compounds in development. And we thought, given the continued interest in CETP, it's essential to differentiate between compound failures and target failures. Of course, if the target is invalid, then any compound you develop that has to act through the target is also going to fail. So it can potentially save a lot of money if we would have found this out, of course, at an early moment. So we decided to look in three lines of evidence, and I'll talk you through them sequentially. First, we actually looked at the phase 3 trials for CETP inhibition, anacetrapib, evacetrapib, dalcetrapib, and torcetrapib that all failed. And we asked ourselves the question, well, if they failed due to on-target effects, then their effects profile should be the same, or at least they should not differ too much. And what we now find is actually that if you look at the difference between their effects profile, they are different in all respects. They even have shown directionally discordant effects, for example, in blood pressure, all-cause mortality, and so on. So we came to the conclusion that clearly they cannot have failed all due to their on-target effects of CETP. So there's potentially still some life left in CETP itself. So what we then subsequently asked was, well, what is the on-target, so the pharmacologically pure effect of CETP perturbation, and compare that to PCSK9 perturbation, which is a more recent, arguably successful drug developed for for decreasing lipid concentrations. Orientating everything in the decreasing PCSK9 or CETP direction, we find that, of course, CETP protects against CHD risk, also heart failure risk, chronic kidney disease, surprisingly, but also has a potentially risk increasing effect on age-related macular degeneration, so eye disease. For PCSK9, we find a similar profile on cardiovascular disease with some additional protective effects on stroke, also on AF. We find also surprising protective effect on MS and risk increasing effects on asthma and Alzheimer's, where Alzheimer's we actually shown before as well in an independent study, which is going to be seen as replication. As I said, we can also use non-protein biomarkers that are affected by the drug of interest. So for CETP, we looked at weighing the analysis by HDL-C, LDL-C, or TGS proxies. And for PCSK9, we simply use LDL cholesterol. And we find that we essentially have the same effects profile as when we weigh it by the genetic association on the protein. And additionally, because these GWASs are a little bit larger, we find protective effects of CETP on diabetes, which we already know from the trials to be there. Also an effect on AF, so atrial fibrillation. And for PCSK9, we actually find more or less the exact same effects profile if you weigh it by a downstream biomarker proxy. Finally, we also had some access to a large sample size NMR metabolomics, allowing us to actually look in detail in the lipids profile. Of course, we all know that these drugs and drug targets have an effect on lipids. What we now see is that CETP and PCSK9 likely act through a very distinct lipidomics profile, where PCSK9 is very focused on LDL cholesterol. We see that, and potentially also a little bit on IDL cholesterol, we see that CETP actually affects VLDL, HDL cholesterol, also both of the ApoA1 and ApoB lipoproteins. And additionally, to a certain extent, IDL cholesterol, and to a much lesser extent, LDL cholesterol. So the range of CETP is much larger than PCSK9. This also brings us to the conclusions, namely that we feel that previous failures are at least partially related to the drug compound, not necessarily explained away by failures of the drug compound. The distinct metabolomics profiles of PCSK9 and CETP lead us to think that there might actually be some benefit in joint inhibition of both proteins. So basically polypharmacy here. And we also see that there's some utility of CETP and PCSK9 beyond the traditional cardiovascular outcomes. So diabetes and chronic kidney disease, for example, even though this is very much related to each other still. Perhaps somewhat audacious, we say that CETP remains a viable drug target. Clearly very difficult to develop a specific enough compound for, but the drug target itself seems okay based on our analysis. And I hope I also gave an example of how we can actually use common genetic variants and aggregated data to give a very detailed, in this current form, very late stage, but hopefully in future, very early on preclinical setting overview of what you would anticipate to happen if you actually drug a certain protein or gene product. So I'll leave it there for the moment. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, thank you very much, Florian. Very interesting. I'm surprised at, given the fact that a lot of the mechanisms of action, given the genetic profile, seem to be similar between the two drugs, that the LDL targets are completely different. It seems, it's really quite shocking. And I could see why you'd want to go after it. When you see that data, it's sort of, wow, there's something happening there. Of course, combo therapies are fraught with peril, as you're well aware of. What are the next steps then? Because you kind of know where you want to go, but you're using, as I understand it, you're using genetic biomarkers as a proxy. What are you going to try and do now to try and validate this potential combo approach, or at least the segmented approach?
So I think the polypharmacy approach, so currently we have a PhD student actually looking in more of a vectorial MR design, near finished paper. So that's also actually looking quite additive. So more or less confirm what we saw here. In shape of research, I think what we are currently aiming towards is actually positioning this pipeline. I think currently the pipeline is positioned at the stage that we don't really make much of an impact, namely after the drug compound has been developed. I think we want to do this much earlier, integrate this with the available preclinical evidence that is out there from cell animal experiments, and actually use this to identify targets that that we might not want to pursue. So to terminate things early and save costs that way. And hopefully by doing that, improve the yield ultimately as well of the ones that actually do make it into development.
No, it's interesting stuff. Okay, just to remind our audience, we will be taking questions. So if you have a question you want to get in, please use your Q&A button, submit them to the panel. We'll circulate them as we get through. And right now I'd like to introduce our final panelist, Adam Butterworth. Adam, thank you very much for being here today, and we look forward to your presentation. The floor is yours, sir.
Well, thanks very much for the invitation to speak, and going to build on what Jessica and Florian have introduced, and think particularly about the work we've been doing in proteomics and how we can use that to try and find new drug targets, or perhaps to evaluate promising drug targets. I guess for decades, we studied a very small number of proteins. Recent technological advances have now allowed us to survey the proteome at scale. This is data we published 3 years ago now in Nature, which was from a survey of 3,500 proteins circulating in the blood. And we could start to really elucidate the genetic control of these proteins. So this slide shows you, a genetic atlas of different genetic variation on the x-axis here from chromosome 1 to 22. And each of these dots represents an association of a genetic variant with levels of a particular protein. And you can see highlighted here some of the regions of the genome that really light up strongly with many proteins. But we were particularly interested in how we could use very specific genetic variants that are related to specific proteins to help understand about causes of cardiovascular disease and therefore potential drug targets. So we could take the 2,000 or so variant to protein associations here and try and use that in a variety of ways. Now, one of the questions I think that already came in the chat was about, in response to Jessica's presentation, was we're doing these ever larger genome-wide association studies and finding more and more signals for disease. But how do we understand, how do we turn that into understanding the genes and the biological pathways? So in the next few slides, I want to give an illustration of that. This is data from a very large new genome-wide association study of coronary artery disease with now more than a million participants in it. And from that study, we have nearly 250 different regions of the genome that seem to be related to coronary disease. Now, the very first signal for coronary disease, well-known on chromosome 9, still hasn't yet been fully biologically elucidated. So my response to the question would be that actually the more starting points we have, then the more perhaps easy to understand targets we might find. So we found a signal here on chromosome 11. This is one of the kind of plots that Jessica showed earlier. There's maybe a dozen genes in the region. And just from this plot alone, we can't really tell what is the key gene and therefore what's the biological pathway. But if we overlap this with our proteomic data, we found that there's a signal in exactly the same place for this protein here that you see in the middle, called SWAP70. Now, we might want to understand a bit more about how the mechanism of how this plasma protein, the SWAP70 protein, might affect atherosclerosis and coronary disease. We could start to overlap with some of our other traits as well. So for example, GUS we've done of hematological traits, in this case, highlighting platelet and red cell traits that seem to overlap as well, but also more common conventional risk factors, such as blood pressure. And so what one can do by overlaying the proteomic data with the genetic data we have is to, as Jessica was saying, start to understand all of these kind of biological insights by building up a story, by saying, well, we have this particular allele, in this case, the T allele at this particular variant, and that seems to, people who carry that seem to have higher levels of SWAP70 in their blood. They seem to have altered hematological parameters. They also have lower systolic and diastolic blood pressure and therefore lower coronary disease risk. And this really provides you then with a set of hypotheses that one can then take into the lab to design experimental studies to start to say, what is the exact mechanistic process here? Could the SWAP70 pathway or related proteins, could they be targeted in a way that would help us develop orthogonal therapeutics to help with preventing cardiovascular events? So that's one way we can do this. The other way that other speakers have already mentioned is the kind of paradigm of Mendelian randomization. So starting with the proteins and those genetic variants associated with them, and then trying to say, well, which proteins seem to have causal effects on different diseases. So this is work that then built on that earlier protein work that we'd published and brought together four or five of those different studies, and then said, well, we can now develop these so-called instrumental variables for about 1,000 proteins. Why don't we test these across as many different diseases and traits as we can? And you see on this kind of colorful plot here, the results of that, looking at lots of different conditions. The blue points here are cardiovascular conditions. And of course, we saw some strong signals that have been touched on already. For example, PCSK9, which is a good kind of positive control here. We had other plausible genes or proteins like factor 11 from the clotting cascade. LPA, which codes for lipoprotein little A, but other less well-known ones, including the SWAP70 that I showed you previously. So again, we have a whole set here. Each of these blue points might represent a starting point for identifying potential druggable target for a particular cardiovascular condition. So finally, I want to go beyond the idea of kind of causal yes or no, qualitative readouts, and say, I think to some of the point of the questions in this webinar, how do we ensure there's going to be quantitative magnitude? So I think the REVEAL trial showed nicely with anacetrapib that CETP is a viable target, but unfortunately you have to do a trial that's so long and so large that actually the effect size that you get out of it at the end in the trial is perhaps not going to make a dent on market share. So this is an example that we use with lipoprotein little A. We know from years of research on LDL cholesterol, shown here on the left, we know about the relationship between observational studies here in the blue. We know about the effects of statin lowering and other LDL lowering agents. So what do the short-term trial estimates show? And we know what the genetic estimates show. So if we instrument LDL cholesterol by using genetic variants that relate to LDL cholesterol, we know about the ratio here between genetic estimates, observational estimates, and trial estimates. We tried to then apply the same approach with this protein, lipoprotein little A, to say, we know the observational estimates from our data, we could generate the genetic estimates, and one can therefore try and predict what the effect would be in a short-term trial. And the striking, if perhaps slightly challenging conclusion from that was that really to get a similar effect estimate in a trial as one would see in a statin trial, so maybe a 22% relative risk reduction, one would need to lower LP little a by about 100 milligrams per deciliter. So quite a substantial lowering. And of course, the challenge with that is that there are therapeutics now there are antisense oligonucleotides that can lower LP little a by about 80 to 90%, but only a small proportion of most people, at least European ancestry people, would have sufficiently high LP little a to give that 100 milligram per deciliter reduction. So actually this work, which was part funded by Novartis, has helped them design their Horizon phase 3 trial, which has an entry criteria of being at least 70 milligrams per deciliter. So of course that's hugely challenging because it requires an enormous screening study before the trial can go ahead, but it perhaps helps to ensure that we can design trials such that the magnitude of reduction in cardiovascular events might be sufficient to have something that we can take forward and therefore have some impact on market and not just understanding of causal pathways. So that trial won't read out for a few years, but we'll be waiting to see if our quantitative predictions of risk reduction turn out to be realistic or not. So thanks to all the funders, particularly Big Data at Heart and IMI and British Heart Foundation, who've helped generate these data and fund this work.
Thank you very much, Adam. Touching on that trial, what sort of database size and what sort of N were you looking at when you were trying to get that screening in order to find that 70% level? That's a tough bar to pass. What sort of numbers were we looking at?
Right. So Novartis has worked with many of the cardiology centers around the US and Europe and other parts of the world to try and do this pre-screen. And in fact, they started the pre-screen. They had to start the pre-screen several months, if not a year, I think, before the trial could start to actually bank enough patients who had sufficiently high Lp(a) levels. So they're getting something like a 10% success rate. And this is among patients with various established cardiovascular disease already. So this is taking patients who come in paying, you know, the cost of the screening test. So ultimately there's this trade-off, right, between getting people at really extreme levels of Lp(a) in whom you might get a bigger effect size versus the upfront cost of having to screen 10 people per person recruited. So right. It's kind of precision medicine in action for cardiovascular, which we at least in common kind of atherosclerotic conditions, we haven't seen a lot of. It's been you know, LDL and blood pressure lower is better in everybody. This is probably an example where actually targeted therapeutic intervention will be the way to go here.
Yeah, thank you very much. No, it's very interesting. So again, ladies and gentlemen, there are 40 of you online. We very much look forward to having your questions. You can use the Q&A button. Obviously, we've got some questions here we can certainly present to ourselves, but if you have anything you want to ask to the panelists, please feel free to jump in. We're sort of dancing around the PCSK9 issue a little bit. I think we may as well just jump right in and hit that. So Florian, I'll start with this. Obviously, one of the problems we've seen with PCSK9 is that whilst it's, you know, 20% better, at least from a research standpoint and outcome standpoint, than many of the statins that were generic, the fact is it hasn't been a commercial success, partially because the statins are free and the genetic treatment, a genetic-based gene therapy with a monoclonal antibody, at least, has not been sufficient market improvement to justify the investment or at least the expense for people to buy it. When you're approaching your research now with this in hindsight, how are you dealing with that? And what sort of numbers are we going to need then if 20% isn't enough? Are we finding the targets you need to hit?
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks for this very relevant question, I think, Duane. I do wonder if that 20% is actually correct. I've also led the Cochrane review on PCSK9 monoclonal antibodies. And what we actually find is that most of the evidence is based on placebo-controlled trials where they use statins as a background therapy. They have done trials actually against statins in combination with ezetimibe. I don't think they've actually done that many statin-only comparative trials. And we actually judge those trials to be of limited to weak evidence or quality. Quality is so harsh, I would say certainty, simply because
you're among friends here, that's fine.
I mean, honestly, the trials in compared to other drug trials have been conducted very thoroughly, I should say, on that. But I think the active comparative trials were of weaker evidence grade, at least. Smaller sample size, mostly targeting what they should be doing actually is FH patients. So in people where their statin therapy might not be sufficiently effective. So in that respect, I think mostly the problem is that we are looking at something very specific to lipid therapy where statins are, as you say, essentially so cheap, so successful that you might want to question why do we need to develop additional therapies for the general patient that has hypercholesterolemia. I think if you now want to target and develop a compound for people with FH, that's much, very much necessary and much needed. However, there, of course, the potential to actually make a profit is more limited by the number of users. So I guess there is some kind of fault there in the health economic assessment where they potentially expect this to be of general utility. And instead, very rightly so, I think NICE and all other, globally speaking, agencies related to costing and costing decisions decided, well, this might be more appropriate to the high-risk group that are either statin intolerant or FH patient, which is, of course, much more limited.
Right, and then you're only looking at 10 to 15% of the overall population, exactly, which then limits the commercial viability. So Adam and Jessica, I'm going to come to you. I know you're having some screen trouble, but it's nice to see you now. So obviously what you folks are working on is on the targeting efficiency side from your standpoint, the bandwidth side to be able to get more efficient approaches to drug discovery. How far away are we from shortening this? Because, you know, cardiovascular trials are known to take 10, 12 years and to get the outcomes. How far are we from getting this down to 3 or 4 years, like, you know, a cancer trial? I mean, how are we doing?
I'd say we are, well, of course, it's very difficult to compare, right? All the various disease areas, focus areas. I think what's most important here is that we have to make things more efficient. We have always, you know, more data than basically people working on it. So we should make sure that we collaborate a lot, share data, share means. And this is also, for instance, the reason why I'm really happy that within the IMI, we not only work with academics, but also with, for instance, pharmaceutical partners, because they have a lot of different skill sets, expertise, also equipment, access to different data sets. We have access to data sets they don't have access to, but also the other way around. And I think that is actually one of the main reasons why, you know, if anyone can accelerate this, it will be these types of collaborations.
And Adam, from your standpoint, you were discussing how Novartis had to go basically everywhere to get enough data. How far are we away from Europe just having enough data on its side? And how is big data at heart helping that? And what are the sort of challenges that you see as a researcher from your perspective in the EU, or, well, formerly of the EU, now of the UK? How are you dealing with that from your clinical practice?
Well, I think the value of the academic collaboration is it's global, right? And I think to the question earlier about, you know, loss of function variants is a good example. We need bigger studies, but we also need more diverse studies. And actually, there's plenty of low-hanging fruit from other populations where, you know, we may not see that there's a knockout for a particular gene we're interested in European ancestry populations, even in 500,000 in UK Biobank or some of the other very large sequencing studies that are going on. But actually, with relatively smaller numbers of other understudied populations, one can start to find knockouts that don't exist in the populations we study. So I think diversity will become increasingly important, as well as large sample size. So I think numbers is one way to get around things and to get better estimates, but also diversity will help enhance that over the coming decade.
So it's not just a bigger hose, it's also better targeting.
Right, exactly. And I think the same will be true, you know, to your question around, you started this out by saying we have effective LDL lowering, we have effective blood pressure lowering in cardiovascular. That makes the trials pretty challenging to do. And I think the precision approach is going to be the way. You know, why is it that most people who still have heart attacks don't necessarily have high blood pressure or high LDL cholesterol? What else is, what other pathways are there that we haven't yet touched on? And how can we develop targets for that subgroup of people who experience that high risk factor?
Yeah, and that gets us to your SWAP 70 target, but I'll get back to you there. Florian, please. No, go ahead, Florian, please. Go ahead.
I'm just going to fully agree with Adam. I think our most recent success in drug development is very much based on designing compounds to actually combat and lower risk factors for disease, so LDL cholesterol and blood pressure. I think now with the work that Adam's been doing, that we've been doing jointly as well, we're now much more in a position to actually start evaluating the effects a protein or some kind of other drug target might have on disease, irrespective of what might be the mediating pathway. And by doing so, we are hopefully gonna find additional novel proteins, and in future are going to be able to understand which pathways they might act upon. But even without that knowledge, we can still design or at least look and see which of these proteins or drug gene products might be amenable to interference from drug compound. And we can start designing drugs for these proteins and drug targets, and by doing so also answer the question on the potential mediating pathways, of course.
Right. And so essentially, if we look at how PCSK9 worked, what we found was, while there was a bunch of people who had very, very low LDL, and then we thought, oh, well, they all have this genetic mutation. What you're doing now, if I understand it from SWAP 70, is you're saying, okay, SWAP 70 has an action, and then you're identifying the action based on from the targeting that you're doing. So that gives us better models. Is that okay? Exactly. So that should increase the efficiency. That gets to my next question then. Obviously, one of the problems we're having is where we have good models, where we have effective modeling, we do get good drugs. But increasingly, it's the modeling that's giving, you know, we're essentially trying to substitute high throughput bandwidth screening, you know, 10 to the power of 7 molecules into bad models and just sort of going the scattergun approach. how is what you're working on technically going to improve those numbers? Who wants to take that?
Maybe I can start and
sure.
Can chip in. I think you know, we often, and the way I presented the discovery work is very much from a biological standpoint. It's not from the starting point of, you know, helping a company with a specific drug target. And what we often find is the challenge is threading that needle. When we've worked with pharma companies who've asked us for help on specific targets, often the human genetic data are somewhat negative or perhaps inconclusive. Conversely, you may find examples like SWAP70 that may be great biological stories, but may be you know, very difficult to drug or may have important on-target safety concerns of the kind that Florian was talking about. So I think one of the challenges meeting all these in the middle, of course, on top of that, you throw then the ultimate kind of economic viability of this. And, you know, many companies have shut down or slimmed down their cardiovascular profile because of the challenge of the large trials. So I think it's about working more closely with industry. How do we help evaluate their targets earlier so that we can actually, you know, it's as important in my eyes to weed out the ones that are never going to work from the ones that we think could work. And that can certainly make things more efficient. But how do we make sure that we're not just doing this from a kind of academic publications exercise, but really trying to focus? And again, as Jessica said, you know, that's where IMI, I think, is really useful because it's helping us more quickly come to the targets of interest and to swap between the kind of academic biology and the what's in the preclinical and early development space with pharma.
Yeah, Jessica, then coming to you, how are you working in this space then trying to balance the sort of targeting side with the economic side? How do you square that circle internally where you know you need to have funding to do this, but also you need to, you know, go after what the science is leading you? How do you make that decision?
Yeah, really good question. And this is actually something that also funders constantly ask, right? Right, maybe 10 years ago, they would say, oh yeah, just, you know, do whatever you like, you're a scientist, you're smart enough, and good luck and see where it leads. Now, way more often you get this question, like, what if you find something, what are you going to do? And if you don't find anything also, you know, do you have a plan B? And, you know, what are you going to do with the results? So for me specifically, as an example, for instance, I have a large project where we try to identify loss of function mutations for dilated cardiomyopathy. And the problem with most cardiomyopathies, specifically dilated cardiomyopathies, is that there is not really medication out there that serve as a real treatment. So, you know, you can make sure that people sort of feel better. You can relieve a little bit for a couple of years, but in the end, they will need a cardiac transplantation or mechanical support. So we really, you know, there's a strong need if we find a loss of function mutation that's actually associated with dilated cardiomyopathy to move forward quickly. And therefore we already, when we, even before we got the funding, we already discussed with pharmaceutical companies. And this is again where indeed our contacts within the consortium come really handy. Where we were asked, hey, you know, what do we do when we identify these targets? What are your next steps? What are we going to work on? And then there's, from our side, there's sort of the cheap option, right, where we can do in silico analyses, so existing data. For instance, what Adam just presented about the QTL analyses, there's a lot of gene expression data out there, for instance, GTEC-like databases. That we can use to come up with functional follow-up. We have cell lines where we can do knockouts in-house. We have large studies with cases and controls where we, for instance, have cardiac tissue available so we can see, hey, are there any differences for our specific genes of interest in gene expression between, for instance, cardiomyopathy cases and controls? But then, you know, ultimately you will have to move to a company to see what we can do further once we know some of the mechanisms and we know it's a drug target. And this is where Florian and I collaborate a lot to ask the question, whatever I find as a gene of interest, is it actually a potential drug target or is there no way we can ever target this within a cell?
What percentage of the time is it you've discovered something and then you think it has relevance, then you're going out, reaching out to the companies or to the research bodies saying, hey, we want to research this? And what percentage of the time is it maybe an industry body or a company or a biotech saying, hey, we think this is interesting, can you help us discover it? Which way does it normally go for you right now in cardiovascular disease?
Currently, it's more I approach companies. Yeah.
Right.
But I do have to say that, you know, up till very recently, it was just we do research, we publish it. And then, you know, if it comes in like a Nature or Science like journal, we're super happy and then we let it go. So I believe this is already a really big improvement compared to a decade ago. Or even maybe 5 years ago.
Adam, is that your experience too, what you're seeing? It's a, you know, you're taking viable assets out and then saying, hey, we got something here?
But I think what's really changed in my time of doing this is, you know, maybe a decade ago, we were being approached by pharma companies to help us with their human genetics to support cases. Now, of course, there's been this massive investment by pharma in human genetics. So, you know, you have GSK that's invested heavily in 23andMe to effectively tap into millions of people's genetic data with health outcomes, or Amgen that's effectively bought the kind of Icelandic population's genetics. So a lot of this has come in-house. And sure. So actually, it I think it shows the value of the human genetics approach by the way that pharma have kind of said, look, we're not going to take these targets forward anymore unless they're supported by that. So it's they've actually got... you know, really, they've really turned things on its head by bringing it all in-house and doing a lot of their own data. So we often now find that we're working to provide the bits that maybe pharma can't do. And maybe that's, for example, in some of these other domains of omics, like the proteomics or the metabolomics, which maybe aren't as advanced in the public or private databases.
Yeah, that's correct. Thank you. And Florian, from your perspective, do you see the similar sort of action in your work? And do you think cardiovascular disease research is picking up now? Do you see there's more demand for it, or is it still sort of sliding down as you folks are having more success with some of the targeting here?
I guess you mean cardiovascular drug development research, right?
Yes. Yeah.
I actually have never seen it really sliding down too much. I think it failed very often, and I think one of the letdowns, of course, is that it's very difficult to actually move away from lipid targets, blood pressure targets, and actually maybe look towards DCM, as Jessica mentioned, or general heart failure medication have been very difficult to actually yield proper drugs that actually help patients. I think what we are trying to do here as well is also just touching base on what Adam said before is help drug companies and drug trials actually decide which fixed endpoint they might want to actually use in their evaluation as well. Particularly for heart failure, it might be very important because, of course, many of these compounds, as you know, have failed simply because they likely picked the wrong target or at least the wrong intermediate outcome. And therefore, they've invested very much into basically going down the entire funnel of drug development only to come out towards the end and finding, well, it doesn't really act the way we thought it would. And not necessarily because the compound failed, but because the target that they tried to inhibit most likely didn't actually affect the outcome that they were interested in. So that also touched upon, I think, the question you had a while back on how can our work actually decrease the runtime of a drug trial. I would say to an extent, if you compare this with cancer, I would think it would be very difficult simply because if you want to treat people that are in a certain health state, then it just takes a number of years before they develop disease. So if you want to treat people as in, for example, PCSK9 that did not have cardiovascular disease from the start, then that takes a long time for them to develop sufficient number of cases to actually do the trial. If you want to do PCSK9 in people that already have established disease, of course, the number of years you have to follow it up is shorter. But I think what genetics can very much help with is actually, as Adam also showed, is try to pinpoint the population you might want to actually focus on. And that can be a population with a certain elevated concentration of Lp(a), for example, but also can be a population that is more likely to actually have a higher prevalence of the endpoint that you were interested in and target your and design your trial to actually focus on these people first, establishing principle, and then seeing how much you can generalize this to whatever your patient population in hypothetical situation would be.
Yeah, but that requires that the genetic biomarkers as a proxy are accurate and validated then in clinical studies, yeah. Which has always been again, not to be critical, but this has always been, you know, sort of a catch as catch can. When it works, it's great. When it doesn't, it's a problem.
And I think we've also kind of, we are skewing our field a little bit by focusing mostly on the things that work. And
right.
I think there's a whole space of research where things have failed and we never published that because, of course, there's a well-known bias that we only publish positive findings. So you may wonder,
that is changing now, isn't it? I mean, it is changing. Yes, I mean,
it is changing, definitely. And the question, of course, is, but that's a different question, to sure. What extent? And of course, you have all these predatory journals that just publish essentially the most things that might not have seen the light of day before, simply because they lacked quality, not necessarily because they were negative in any way.
No, that's fine. So, Adam, from your perspective, how are you, obviously biomarker validation, if they're genetic, is a key to all of this. How are we doing now with validating those and getting into that effectively? I mean, how are we doing these more effectively now than we were 5 years ago? How has this evolved?
Well, I think to Florian's point, you know, I think we're probably better at parking things that don't look immediately promising. I think certainly, as we've kind of said, I think as the data sets have grown, there's more data out there, there's more targets with some kind of human genetic evidence to validate from. And I think the availability of some of this intermediate data as well. I mean, Jessica talked about some of the experimental systems and the models, the cell lines, et cetera, that have developed. But I think also the availability of open access data that links genetic variation with various intermediate traits, whether it's gene expression or protein levels or metabolites, et cetera. I think that's all helping fill in the gap between kind of DNA variant and disease outcome, so that one can have confidence in the target being likely efficacious, but also understand more quickly the mechanism and move more quickly through that preclinical process.
Yeah, that's, thank you. And this goes to our next question. We have a question here from Mark Massenbaugh. Thank you very much, Mark. Jessica, I'll throw this to you first. Again, why focus on genetic markers to stratify risk rather than proteins? Obviously, genetics are upstream from proteins. That's a simple question, but what's the benefit, Jessica? Why do it?
I would say the main benefit from genetics is that you never have any confounding issues. So, whereas with probably any other type of research, you do have, for genetics, at conception, basically your gene is, or your set of genetics is determined, plus that this is, the basic principle of Mendelian randomization, of course, that you are a sort of random combination of your parents. And so as world population, we end up with a sort of randomized clinical trial in genetic terms.
That's great. Adam, anything to add to that? Why would you go for a genetic marker as opposed to a protein?
Well, I think, for example, the lipoprotein protein little A example is something of an outlier because it's actually a protein that's kind of largely driven by its genetic variation. But actually, there's an example of where the trial itself is being, participants not being selected on the basis of the genetic variants they carry, but on the measurements of the protein itself, right?
But you're validating it with the genetic footprint.
Right. So you're validating the efficacy with the the genetic information to make sure that it's really a causal marker. We have other examples I didn't show today, but there are nice ones where, for example, it looks like the predictive value of the plasma protein is actually directionally opposite to the causal direction. So, for example, we think these are things probably biomarkers that are released in response to myocardial damage, for example.
Right.
So the higher the level of the protein, the more damage is there. But this is actually a kind of rescue biomarker, if you like. So I think having the genetics helps us anchor the causal effects and work out, which direction, perhaps which magnitude, how much might the effect be. One can imagine as the challenge of these ever larger data sets is we're finding smaller and smaller effects. And sometimes that's going to mean, the recent genetic data I mentioned on coronary disease kind of finally discovers HMGCR, that the target of statins, which has never really come up at genome-wide significance in a heart disease GUS before. So it is possible to have that, there's only very weak genetic variants. And then sometimes that's going to mean that the targets aren't efficacious. But, we believe that, much like the statins example, because the therapeutics can target a pathway much more strongly than naturally occurring genetic variation, that there's still potential to find some targets out there that aren't only scientifically interesting but will give sufficient magnitude and be sufficiently druggable to have make a difference.
That's great, Adam. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we are unfortunately running near the time, near the end of our webinar here. It's unfortunate. It's a great conversation, a lot very enjoyable. I do have one more question. Jessica, you've alluded to the sort of network opportunities and the sort of collective nature of public-private partnerships such as IMI's Big Data at Heart. Obviously, it's in this case, this is really exciting research. Thank you all for your presentations. What recommendations would you have for other academics who are interested in PPPs? What are the plus sides, downsides, and what are some things they should do if they're interested in getting involved in them? Jessica, I'll start with you. Any recommendations for your fellow academics?
Yeah, I think I just highlighted what I thought was most useful out of it, having different skill sets, equipment, opportunities. I think many academics are, at least that's what I've heard over the past years whenever I brought up this these partnerships, is that people are sort of a bit scared to, what will happen to my data? Do I have to, things like licensing, patenting? I think it's just important to make sure that you're on the same page before you even start. What are the shared expectations? What are the possibilities? But also, what are the things that are impossible? And once you have that clear, I would only be very much in favor of it.
That's great. Florian, from your perspective, any recommendations?
I echo that. I think we should really do these things more often, but very much with established partnerships. Every time try to find if there's more interesting partners there that want to join, that might add to the evidence base and the knowledge base that we accumulate, but of course have a core that we're very comfortable collaborating with.
And Adam, final word to you. Any recommendations for your fellow academic colleagues?
Well, I think this kind of consortium has shown that early dialogue between academia and pharma has been crucially important. How do we make sure we're going after the right indications that the pharma are interested in, and how do we make sure we're looking at the right targets and delivering things that are, likely to shorten that time and to make a more effective drug development process?
Thank you, all three of you, Adam, Florian, and Jessica. It's been a pleasure, really enjoyable work. I wish you all success. For our audience, thank you very much. I'm Duane Schultes, and on behalf of Big Data at Heart, we're now going to close this webinar. Thank you very much for your participation. Have a good afternoon, everyone. Bye-bye.